إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه نستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله لا فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها فكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله رب العالمين All praises due to Allah, the Lord of all the worlds. All praises due to Allah who has guided us to this path and we would not have been able to guide ourselves had not Allah guided us. All praises due to Allah who has revealed the scripture unto his servant and has made no crookedness therein. All praises due to Allah. Nashkuruhu wa nahmaduhu wa nufni alayhi azza wa jalla. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the great, great gift of the Qur'an. And He's given us a Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to explain the Qur'an, to expound on His teachings, to articulate His teachings, both with His words, His speech, His words, His actions, and His states, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah mentions in the Quran, ظَهْرَ الْفَسَادِ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبِحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ That corruption has appeared on land and sea based on what the hands of humans have wrought. The hands of humans have wrought. Thus do we give them a taste the consequences of their deeds in order that they may return. Allah Ta'ala mentions the corruption. There are many understandings of corruption. For example, Ibn Abbas mentions corruption in the sea, is that one of the meanings of that is that the sea will no longer yield its harvest. So we see this form of corruption as we live in a time where they say that 90% of the species in the sea have been extinguished, are extinct. Others that we rely on for food, such as bluefin tuna or yellowfin tuna, are rapidly approaching extinction. Fisheries that were once so abundant and teeming with fish, it would be inconceivable to conceive of their harvest ever being exhausted, such as the Great Banks off the coast of Newfoundland, which have been closed, or recently, maybe reopened, but were recently closed to commercial fishing, because the overfishing was leading to the extinction of the fish, and no harvest whatsoever could be taken. But generally, the corruption is the disruption of the natural order that Allah has established for this world. The natural order existing in the land and the sea, the natural order that exists in our societies, one interpretation of the land and the sea in the towns and the villages. Interesting. Think about that. Bahar al-Fasad في البر والبحر in the towns and in the countryside. Why is that interesting? It's interesting because normally we conceive of the towns, the cities, as the places of corruption, and the countryside being isolated from the city, being isolated from the dislocations that the city represents. Dislocation of traditional religion, dislocation of traditional social structures. As that not existing in the countryside, therefore, the corruption that those dislocations breed in the cities and the towns is absent from the countryside. But now we see a common affliction. The cities are afflicted with drug addiction and alcoholism, as is the countryside. In fact, the countryside, in terms of this recent opioid crisis, is suffering even to greater extents than the city. The cities are afflicted with pollution, and now the countryside, due to industrialized farming, pesticide use poisoning the groundwater. So we see the same ecological challenges that are facing the cities and facing the countrysides. And so Allah Ta'ala is reminding us. He's reminding us that we will suffer from what we do. We'll suffer personally, we'll suffer societally, and we'll suffer globally for what we do. And Allah says He will give us a taste. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not destroy us in one fell swoop, as happened to earlier people. One of the manifestations of the mercy of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was to his enemies, was that when they rebelled against him, when they fought him, when they rejected his mission, Allah didn't destroy them in one fell swoop, as He destroyed the people of Lut, or the Ad, or the Thamud, or others, when He sent. Turn the cities upside down, or send devastating winds. No, Allah, the enemies of the Prophet were given respite. They were given time to repent. They were given time to return to the path of right guidance. They were given time to leave their enmity against the Prophet. And so we see his most bitter enemies, such as Amr bin al-As, or Abu Sufyan, or his wife Hind, or others, leaving their enmity to the Prophet ﷺ, and then themselves becoming believers. This is from the mercy of Muhammad ﷺ. And so we see this reflected in this verse, لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا. To that in order, thus do we give them a taste. We allow them to experience something, a portion of what they've done. But we will not bring down upon them the full consequence. And so Allah Ta'ala is giving us a taste. He's letting us see the harbingers of the full destruction that will come if we don't change our ways. Literally, we see how our greed, how our neglect of the stewardship that we should be exercising in this earth, how it contributes to these devastating fires, such as what we witnessed here a couple weeks ago. And literally, we tasted the consequence of that, as the smoke was filling our nostrils and our mouths, and put it in the taste of it as the days wore on. Literally, this is a wake-up call for us. This is a warning for us And so Allah, He gives us respite, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ, in order that they will return to the path of guidance. We, as Muslims, should be people who are exercising the prophetic responsibility of warning people. As we celebrate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during these days, Rabi'ul Awwal, we should be celebrating the fact that he was a witness. Ya ayyuhan nabi inna arsalnaka shahidan wa sirajan munira. We should celebrate his witnessing, and we ourselves should be a witness, which is a responsibility our Lord has given us. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا. And this primarily is speaking of our witnessing against other nations in the Akhirah, witnessing that Allah indeed sent their messenger to them to guide them, and they have no excuse. But there's a manifestation of that in the world. We should be witnesses for truth and witnesses for justice. كُنُوا قَوَامِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ. So there's a worldly manifestation. So we should be witnesses as he was a witness. وَمُبَشِّرًا. And we should be givers of glad tidings. But to truly and effectively give that message, we ourselves have to be recipients of those glad tidings. If you leave alcoholism, if you leave drug addiction, then you can have inner peace such that you don't need those things. You won't need alcohol, you won't need opiates to deal with the pain of living. You won't need these things. And this isn't just something we talk about, this is something we should bear witness to through our very being. That the serenity, the peace that they see within us, the calm that they see within us, convinces them that we're speaking the truth. And this was the witness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was a witness, a living witness to what he called to. Mubashiran, glad tidings. You can have a good life, you can have a wholesome life, you can have a productive life without these things. Wa nadhira, and a warner. If you don't return, there are consequences. If you continue down this path, there are consequences. Far too many Muslims, because we're not witnesses, because we're not practicing what we're preaching, and of course, this isn't everybody, it's not most of us, but there are enough of us that it dilutes the power of our communal message. Ummatan wasata, a balanced middle community. So we have a communal message. We can be scattered individuals, but we will not impact our society until people say, look at those Muslims. Not look at Ahmed, my co-worker, Ahmed, Abdullah, Fatima, Aisha, Amatullah. Such a pious person, such an honest person, a person of so much integrity. Our strength and our contribution and our corrective effect in our society will not be actualized until people say, look at those Muslims. They have so much integrity. They have such sterling character. They are so honest in their dealings. They are a community that are afflicted with drug addiction and alcohol. Those Muslims don't drink. Those Muslims don't lie. Those Muslims, they're not affected by the things that are driving us crazy. That's when we'll have an impact. And that's when the
the warning we give will be heeded. That's when the glad tidings that we offer will be accepted. So we should be a community that is warning people, a community that is leading people. And it starts at the top. Al-ulama wa rafatul anbiya. The scholars are the heirs of the prophets. As they say, zanatul alim, zanatul alam. The scholar slips, the whole world follows. The whole world slips. So this is a collective endeavor. But it's an endeavor we must challenge ourselves with. And one of the most important things for us to realize is that facade that is threatening the existence of our nation, that is threatening the existence of our world, is not something we Muslims are responsible for. So why are we so ashamed of being proud? Or why are we so ashamed of saying we're Muslims and we have solutions? We're not responsible for this opiate crisis. We didn't create the conditions that drove people to the lengths of despair that are manifested in opium and other diseases, addiction and other diseases of despair. Alcoholism, drug addiction, suicide. We mentioned these earlier, a few weeks ago. We're not responsible for those conditions. So why are we so hesitant to say that perhaps we can address them? Perhaps we have something that can lead or provide insight as to how we might surmount them. We're definitely not responsible for the resurgent racism that's tearing this country apart at the seams. It's been here from the beginning of the country before there was any significant Muslim populations other than the enslaved African Muslims. So why are we, as opposed to representing and presenting and being proud and calling people wada'iyan ilallahi, why are we following people in the things that are leading them to their destruction? Why are we so eager to jump onto the Titanic after it's hit the iceberg? We should be helping people to get off of that ship. Because we, generally speaking, we are not actualized to the depth of our souls what it means to be a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we actualize what it means to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, everything we need as a community, Allah will give to us. Starting with the confidence to proudly say, I'm a Muslim. وَمَنْ أَحْسِنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وعمل الصالح وقال إنني من المسلمين. There be no hesitation. There be no hesitation. There be no hesitation to point out to people destructive things. And there be great hesitation to abandon لعلهم يرجعون in order that they return. Meaning what? Going back to something of value that's been abandoned. And again, that has to start with us as Muslims. the values, the customs, their traditions, the way of seeing reality that our forebears had is something of tremendous value. Only when it's abandoned do we see what we see. Only when it's abandoned do we suffer from what we suffer as Muslims in our Muslim lands. And many Muslims in these Western lands. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. It's not working. So perhaps when there was greater stability, when there was greater self-confidence, when there was stronger faith, when there was less hesitancy to jettison our religion. Look at the haste. One person's a Muslim today and they read something, a tweet. And the tweet was so discombobulating, tomorrow they're not even a Muslim. Our Prophet warned against that. And he taught us to protect ourselves against it. Why did he teach us to pray? يَا مُقَلِّبَ الْقُلُوبِ ثَبِّتْ قَلْبِ عَلَى دِينِكِ. The one who can turn the heart in an instant. Confirm my heart in your religion. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Individuals, يَرْجِعُونَ, repenting. Going back to that state of purity that existed before the sin. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Societies going back to those values, to those beliefs. Far too many Muslims want to be progressive. I'm a progressive Muslim. We know what that means. I'm a licentious Muslim. I'm a Muslim that doesn't value the things of the past that gave us the strength, the fortitude to live in this world as dignified human beings. We need reactionary Muslims. Muslims who want to go backwards. Because we see where this forward march is leading us. As an ummah,
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala Sayyidina Mursaleen, Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima kithira. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Sometimes when people hear what you just heard, the weightiness of it all can be overwhelming. And indeed it can be if one endeavors to assume those responsibilities, to carry that those loads by themselves. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not enjoined upon us to assume that responsibility alone, to carry those loads alone. Allah ta'ala has asked us to depute the affair unto Him, to allow Him to carry the load, to allow Him to bear the burden, and to allow Him, or not to be an obstacle within our realm of initiative, and our realm of creation, and our realm of choice to the ability to do what we have been enjoined to do. Then it's easy. And where does that ease come from? That ease comes from living a life and assuming the responsibilities that we assume to
bear the loads that have been placed upon our shoulders with the remembrance of Allah in our hearts. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنَّ الْقُلُوبِ. Does not the remembrance of Allah bring comfort, tranquility to the hearts? So no matter what the world places upon us, by the leave of Allah, no matter what challenges we're presented with, no matter what obstacles are in our course, if we bear them and approach them and deal with them with a heart that's filled with the remembrance of Allah, then we'll be at ease. The vicissitudes of the day will not tear us apart. They will not break us down. They will not crush us. We'll be people, where do you find joy? How do you find joy? And all that's going on around us, the news is so bad. One reason the news is so bad is the means that convey the news to us are so bad. If it bleeds, it leads, as they say. And once you're caught up in this cycle of sensationalism, we need more blood to be interested. There are good things happening in this world. The good things happening in your life. There are good things happening in our communities. And there are definitely challenging things. But no matter what the challenges, if we reflect on the grace and mercy of Allah, we're all here, we're well clothed. The rain didn't penetrate this roof. We're not sitting in puddles with buckets all over the place. We're not sitting in mud, sitting on carpets. We came here in cars. We're going home to refrigerators and cupboards that are filled with food. We have good health. When our health fails, we have doctors and access to doctors. If we find our energy lagging, we go to up the street to Whole Foods and buy some vitamins or some moringa powder. And our energy is restored. We're surrounded by the blessings and the graces and the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we give thanks for those gifts, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. Say, in the grace of Allah and in His mercy. And the greatest grace and mercy is Islam and the Quran and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But in those beneath that, that we enjoy every day, in this let them rejoice. How can we not rejoice? But we invert things. We invert things and look at them through the wrong prism. We look at them through the prism of the dunya. We look at them from the prism of the finitude of the dunya, as opposed to looking at them through the infinity of the akhirah. We look at them from the prism of man's shortcomings and man's imperfection, humanity's shortcomings and humanity's imperfection, as opposed to looking at them through the perfection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And understand that perfection is manifested in the wisdom and the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what we might see and view as being imperfect, when we look at it from the prism of the imperfection of humans, is as perfect as it can get when we look at it from the prism of the perfection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just involves a shift in perspective. May Allah bless us to shift our perspective. May Allah Ta'ala bless us to have hearts that are content and at ease and at rest. May Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala bless us to rejoice and the manifestations of His grace and His mercy that are visited upon us every second of our existence in this world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us to see ourselves as a source of a solution and not as part of a problem. May Allah ta'ala bless us to do those actions and to entertain those thoughts and to engage in those words that are a reflection of the teaching and the significance and the import and the impact of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this world. Allahumma ighfir lil muslimin wal muslimat wal mu'minin wal mu'minat al ahya' minhum wal amwat. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. ربنا افرغ علينا صبرا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا افرغ علينا صبرا وثبت أقدامنا وتوفنا مسلمين. واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من الهم والحزن ونعوذ بك من العجز والكسل ونعوذ بك من الجبن والبخل ونعوذ بك من غلبة الدين وكبر الرجال. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معاصيك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا بها جنتك ومن اليقين ما يهون علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا وانصرنا على من عدانا ولا تجعل صعيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك ولا يرحمنا يا أرحم الراحمين. واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم فرج عن المسلمين في كل مكان. اللهم فرج عن المسلمين في كل زمان. اللهم فرج عن إخواننا المسلمين وأخواتنا المسلمات في كل بقعة في هذه الأرض في هذه الأرض. يا الله 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 يا الله. اللهم ثبت أقدامنا وطهر قلوبنا واستر عيوبنا. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والغنى والعفاف والمغفرة. أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم من أراد خيرا لهذه الأمة المحمدية فوفقه إلى كل خير ومن أراد شرا لها وللمسلمين فخذ أخذ عزيز مقتدر واجعل تدبيرهم. اللهم عليك بأعداء الإسلام. اللهم خفف عن هذه الأمة. اللهم فرج عن هذه الأمة. اللهم أوقف حروب هذه الأمة. يا الله يا الله يا الله أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أكمل الصلاة يرحمني. الله.